Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Why are you all sat so far away?
Because there was an extra
on that side. Oh, my goodness. Come and sit near the front. Thank you, Si. Wise, I think I've got the wrong deodorant on this morning. It's lovely to welcome you to church today. It's wet and windy out there, but warm and welcoming in here. And we've got an interesting morning because we're starting our new series looking at the book of Judges. So we look forward to that. Well, let's start with our first hymn this morning. Come thou fount of every blessing. Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Grace and peace be with you.
And keep you in the love of Christ.
Father of glory,
holy and eternal, look upon us now in power and mercy. May your strength overcome our weakness, your radiance transform our blindness, and your spirit draw us to that love, shown and offered to us by your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, do be seated as we prepare to confess our sins to God. Lord Jesus, mighty God and Prince of Peace, Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Lord Jesus, Son of God and Son of Mary, Christ have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Lord Jesus, Word made flesh and splendour of the Father, Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
So we take a moment's quiet. In the quiet we bring to God all those things for which we need his forgiveness. So we say together,
Heavenly Father, we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and have failed to do what we ought to have done. We are sorry and truly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and lead us in his way to walk as children of light.
Yr holl alluog ddiw sy'n maddau i bawb sy'n wired y feirion, y drygahorwth eich, a rhyddau o bechod, eich cod anhau mewn daioni, a cadw yn y bawyd tragwyddo, trwy Iesu Grist a'n haglwydd. Amen. We've confessed our sins, God has forgiven us, because Jesus died and rose again for us. Let's stand to sing God's praises, the Gloria in Excelsis. For the second Sunday after Epiphany. Almighty God, in Christ you make all things new. Transform the poverty of our nature by the riches of your grace, and in the renewal of our lives, make known your heavenly glory. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
I'll do be seated for our reading from Judges.
Our first reading this morning is from Judges chapter 1, beginning at verse 1, reading through to chapter 2, verse 3. After the death of Joshua, the Israelites asked the Lord, "Who of us is to go up first to fight against the Canaanites?" The Lord answered, "Judah shall go up. I have given the land into their hands." The men of Judah then said to the Simeonites, their fellow Israelites, "Come up with us into the territory allotted to us to fight against the Canaanites. We in turn will go with you into yours." So the Simeonites went with them. When Judah attacked, the Lord gave the Canaanites and the Perizzites into their hands, and they struck down 10,000 men at Bezek. It was there that they found Adonai Bezek and fought against him, putting to rout the Canaanites and the Perizzites. Adonai Bezek fled, but when they chased him and caught him and cut off his thumbs and big toes. Then Adonai Bezek said, 70 kings with their thumbs and big toes cut off have picked up scraps under my table. Now God has paid me back for what I did to them." They brought him to Jerusalem, and he died there. The men of Judah attacked Jerusalem also and took it. They put the city to the sword and set it on fire. After that, Judah went down to fight against the Canaanites, living in the hill country, the Negev and the western foothills. They advanced against the Canaanites living in Hebron, formerly called Kiriath Arba, and defeated Sheshai, Ahiman, and Talmai. From there they advanced against the people living in Debir, formerly called Kiriath Sefer. And Caleb said, "I will give my daughter Aksar in marriage to the man who attacks and captures Kiriath Sefer." Othniel, son of Kenaz, Caleb's younger brother, took it. So Caleb gave his daughter Aksar to him in marriage. One day when she came to see Othniel, she urged him to ask her father for a field. When she got off her donkey, Caleb asked her, "What can I do for you?" She replied, "Do me a special favor. Since you have given me land in the Negev, give me also the springs of water." So Caleb gave her the upper and lower springs. The descendants of Moses' father-in-law, the Kenites, went up from the city of Palms with the people of Judah to live among the inhabitants of the desert of Judah in the Negev near Arad. Then the men of Judah went with the Simeonites, their fellow Israelites, and attacked the Canaanites living in Zephath, and they totally destroyed the city. Therefore it was called Hormah. Judah also took Gaza, Ashkelon, and Ekron, each city with its territory. The Lord was with the men of Judah. They took possession of the hill country, but they were unable to drive the people from the plains, because they had chariots fitted with iron. As Moses had promised, Hebron was given to Caleb, who drove from it the three sons of Anak. The Benjaminites, however, did not drive out the Jebusites, who were living in Jerusalem. To this day, the Jebusites live there with the Benjaminites. Now the tribes of Joseph attacked Bethel, and the Lord was with them. When they sent men to spy out Bethel, formerly called Luz, the spies saw a man coming out of the city, and they said to him, "Show us how to get into the city, and we'll see that you are treated well." So he showed them, and they put the city to the sword, but spared the man and his whole family. He then went to the land of the Hittites, where he built a city and called it Luz, which is its name to this day. But Manasseh did not drive out the people of Beth-shan, or Tanakh, or Dor, or Ibleam, or Megiddo, and their surrounding settlements, for the Canaanites were determined to live in that land. When Israel became strong, they pressed the Canaanites into forced labor, but never drove them out completely. Nor did Ephraim drive out the Canaanites living in Giza, but the Canaanites continued to live there among them. Neither did Zebulun drive out the Canaanites living in Kitron or Nahalol. So these Canaanites lived among them, but Zebulun did subject them to forced labor. Nor did Asher drive out those living in Akko, or Sidon, or Arlab, or Achzib, or Helabah, or Aphek, or Rehob. The Asherites lived among the Canaanite inhabitants of the land, because they did not drive them out. Neither did Naphtali drive out those living in Beth Shemesh or Beth Anath, but the Naphtalites too lived among the Canaanite inhabitants of the land. And those living in Beth Shemesh and Beth Anath became forced laborers for them. The Amorites confined the Danites to the hill country, not allowing them to come down into the plain. And the Amorites were determined also to hold out in Mount Heres, Ajalon, and Shalbim. But when the power of the tribes of Joseph increased, they too were pressed into forced labor. The boundary of the Amorites was from Scorpion Pass to Sela and beyond. The angel of the Lord went up from Gilgal to Bochim and said, I brought you up out of Egypt and led you into the land that I swore to give to your ancestors. I said, I will never break my covenant with you, and you shall not make a covenant with the people of this land, but you shall break down their altars. Yet you have disobeyed me. Why have you done this? And I have also said, I will not drive them out before you. They will become traps for you, and their gods will become snares to you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thanks, Heather. Well, don't lose that. You will need it when we come to look at it in a few minutes' time. Now we're going to sing again. Jesus, lover of my soul. We'll stay seated as we sing this.
Thank you.
Would you stand for our gospel reading? Today's gospel is John chapter 1. I'm just going to read verses 29 to 34. It's page 1063. John chapter 1, beginning to read at verse 29. Listen to the gospel of Christ according to St. John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The next day, John saw Jesus coming towards him and said, "Look, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. This is the one I meant when I said, 'A man who comes after me has surpassed me, because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to Israel." Then John gave this testimony: "I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. And I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, 'The man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit.' I have seen and testify that this is God's chosen one." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your word to us. We thank you for the familiar passages which bring us comfort through their very familiarity. And we pray for the passage, we thank you for the passages that we aren't so familiar with. We pray, Father, this morning that you would teach us from your word, that by your Holy Spirit you would open up our eyes so that we can see what you have to teach us this morning, and our hearts so that we might fully obey. For we ask in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. I'll do be seated. When a prominent and perhaps much loved leader dies or retires, it leaves a huge gap. This last year we have lost our Queen, the only monarch many of us can remember, and we wonder, how will King Charles measure up? Here in our own diocese, we've seen the retirement of June, our bishop, who oversaw many changes, and we wonder, what on earth will our new bishop do? Supporters of the Welsh football team had the shock announcement of Gareth Bale's retirement. Gareth Bale led the team on an amazing journey, success in the Euros, a place in the World Cup. Who will rise up to fill his boots? And that's the same question we find ourselves asking at the start of the book of Judges. The first five words are stark: after the death of Joshua. Joshua, that great faithful leader of God's people, has gone. What will happen to the people now? And the answer is a salutary tale. Things do not go well. The whole of the book of Judges shows the people descending deeper and deeper into chaos and godlessness. Without the strong godly leadership of a Moses or a Joshua, the people very quickly move from wholehearted obedience to God to a partial obedience, to such a twisted obedience that it's pretty much unrecognisable. And as we live in a post-Christian era, with great Christian leaders seemingly a thing of the past, we have much to learn from this book. Though the events happened nearly 3,200 years ago, what they tell us about our own fickleness and the contrasting mercy of God are timeless. Well, let's remind us of where these events fit in the story of the Bible. You'll remember that way back, almost at the very start of the Bible, God had promised to make Abraham a nation. He called him out of Ur in the Chaldees and told him to go to the land that he would give him. In Abraham's lifetime, though he did purchase part of the land as a burial ground, never really possessed it. He and his eventual children and grandchildren lived in tents, alongside, but generally apart from, the Canaanite people. And when a severe famine hit the Middle East and North Africa, the family moved to Egypt, where great-grandson Joseph was second in command. Time passed, and the people were turned from guests in Egypt into slaves. And they remained there until eventually God raised up Moses to lead them out of Egypt in the Exodus. But in Moses' time, the people never quite made it into the promised land. And the book of Exodus ends with the death of Moses. Yet God will keep his promise. Joshua had been unswervingly faithful, and he was the one to lead the people into the promised land. We read about it in the book that's named after him. You could read it as a prequel to what we're doing in this series. And the book of Joshua ends on a high note. Much of the land is conquered, and the people, as one, have promised to serve the Lord. But then Joshua dies. And Judges starts with the unspoken question, what will the people do now? Joshua is dead. Well, they begin well. Verse 1, the Israelites asked the Lord. They asked the Lord. Great. That's exactly what any of us should do when we face trials or changes or when we don't know what to do next. Ask God. He knows. He can see round the corners of our future. Ask the Lord. The Israelites do. But sadly, that's about as good as it gets. They ask, who of us will go up first to fight against the Canaanites? And God says, Judah, I have given the land into their hands. But just about what happens next? They go and ask the Simeonites to help. You might say, well, what's wrong with that? Well, they didn't actually need the help. God had promised to give them the land. They're like hedging their bets a little bit. Well, we'll just take Simeon with us. Give us a bit of hand if we need it. They didn't need it. God had promised it. It's obedience, but with a little twist on it. It's a tendency that will eventually be their downfall. Nevertheless, God is with them, and they take huge swathes of the land, as do the other tribes. But, and there is a huge but, they don't do it exactly as God has said. Now, back in the time of Moses, in the book of Numbers, God had commanded his people to completely drive out the Canaanite nations. Numbers 33, verses 50 to 54. On the plains of Moab, by the Jordan, across from Jericho, the Lord said to Moses, speak to the Israelites and say to them, when you cross the Jordan into Canaan, drive out all the inhabitants of the land before you. Destroy all their carved images and their cast idols and demolish all their high places. Take possession of the land and settle in it, for I have given you the land to possess. Now there was a very good reason for God asking for the people to completely drive out the Canaanites. Because the instructions continue. Verse 55. But if you do not drive out the inhabitants of the land, then those who you allow to remain will become barbs in your eyes and thorns in your side. They will give you trouble in the land where you will live. And then I will do to you what I plan to do to them. See, if the people are left in the land, They're going to cause trouble. They're actually going to lead God's people astray. They're going to lead them to worship these other gods, to do some of the terrible practices that they were doing, and ultimately bring God's judgment down on his own nation. They'll be completely removed. We actually do see that happen in Bible history. Now, parts of the Bible like this can make us a little squeamish. To our ears, it smacks of abuse of power, like the actions of Putin's Russia in Ukraine, or the horror of the ethnic cleansing in the Balkans. But we need to know that the Canaanite nations aren't the innocent weaklings in all of this. This is what God says in Deuteronomy 9, verse 5. It's not because of your righteousness or your integrity that you're going to take possession of the land, but on account of the wickedness of these nations. The Lord your God will drive them out before you to accomplish what he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So not innocent, weak neighbours. These nations are powerful and wicked. They did things like sacrifice their own children, sanction gang rape, oppose God and his people at every turn. And so God is going to use his people as a means of judgment on these nations. Not because Israel is somehow perfect, he makes it very clear that they're not, but because that's how he chooses to act. God will not put up with wickedness and wrongdoing forever. And actually, rather than being sinister, that's a huge comfort, isn't it? What sort of God would we be following if he didn't destroy evil? Surely our usual gripe is that God doesn't do it soon enough. Why is God letting these people suffer? And this just judgment of God is even acknowledged by one of the Canaanite kings. Did you spot how Adonai Bezek responded to his thumbs and toes being chopped off in verse 7? 70 kings with their thumbs and big toes cut off have picked up scraps under my table. Now God has paid me back for what I did to them. Just judgment. Now at this point, I'd like to make an important aside. One of the big mistakes we make when reading the Bible is to place ourselves at the centre of it. We say, what am I getting from this? We say, I don't read that book, I don't get anything from it. We assume the Bible is a morality tale on which to model ourselves and our lives. So when we read about conquest and killing, and when the heroes are being cruel to animals, as we'll see, or visiting prostitutes, we don't know what to think. Well, surely God doesn't want me to do these things. Well, no, he doesn't. The Bible is a book about God and God's relationship with his people. And the very first question we should ask when we read the Bible is, what is this telling me about God? And the conquest of the land tells us two important things. It tells us that God judges wickedness. And we'll see that as we read through the Bible. Ultimately, there is going to be a day of judgment when we all stand before God, the judge. Our only hope is in Jesus. Also tells us that God keeps his promises. He promised the land and he gives it in spite of the failure of his people. And when we meet flawed leaders in the pages of the Bible, they show us how God's plans work out in spite of, and even sometimes through, weak, troubled people. And I find that a great encouragement to this weak, troubled person. So keep your eyes on God as we read, and on the response of God's people to him. Because from Judges chapter 1 verse 19 things start to take a real dip. I wonder if you spotted the repetition as Heather read. And by the way, I think Heather should have had a round of applause for reading that passage. Fantastic. Woo, all those names. But did you spot the repetition? They were unable to drive out the people from the plains. The Benjaminites did not drive out the Jebusites. Manasseh did not drive out the people of Beth Shan or Tanakh or Dor or Blaim or Megiddo. And on it goes, place after place after place. See, God's people don't fully obey him. They do a bit, but they don't carry it through to the end. Well, there might have been several different reasons for that. Maybe part of it was fear. Those iron chariots that got a mention, they were far beyond any weaponry that the Israelites had. Would God really give them victory over the people with the iron chariots? Shows a lack of trust that God will keep his promise. Maybe it's expediency. Did you notice that many of the people were put into forced labour? Well, that makes far better economic sense. Why drive them out when they can make you money? But God didn't say, make them slaves. Shows a lack of trust that God will provide the standard of living that they need. Or perhaps the reason was sentiment, though I think that probably has more to do with our reading of it rather than what was actually happening at the time. But you could surmise, they might say, well, the people seem okay. God can't really mean we've got to drive them out. It shows a lack of trust in God's goodness. And don't we do all those things? Fail to trust that God will actually do what he says. So we make our own plans just to be on the safe side. Fail to trust that God will provide for us. So we prioritize climbing our career, upsizing our homes, getting more possessions. We fail to trust that God knows what's best. So we sit on judgment on him. God wouldn't want this or that. While at the same time putting pretty much anything else before him and teaching our children to do the same. Partial obedience is not obedience at all. And God calls them out on it. Chapter 2, verse 1. The angel of the Lord went up from Gilgal to Bochim and said, I brought you up out of Egypt and led you into the land I swore to give your ancestors. I said, I will never break my covenant with you. And you shall not make a covenant with the people of this land, but you shall break down their altars. Yet you've disobeyed me. Why have you done this? And I have also said, I will not drive them out before you. They will become traps for you, and their gods will become snares to you. Well, the people hear the words and they weep. They name the place weeping. They make sacrifices. But they're not changed by it in any way. They feel bad. They have remorse, but they don't repent. Repentance involves change. And you know, we can feel the challenge of a Bible passage. We can feel bad and beat ourselves up about stuff. And then the next day forget all about it. True repentance means acting on it, making change. Now the consequences of this people's disobedience isn't felt straight away, just as the consequences of ours often aren't. It's in the generations to come that it really hits, as it is for us, when the God we haven't prioritised isn't even a feature in our children and grandchildren's lives, and society as a whole is going to pop. So this book is a huge warning to us. But it's not without its positives. And if you spotted the mention of Caleb in chapter 1, verse 12, he was the other faithful spy with Joshua, if you remember the story when they go to check out the land of Canaan. And he offers a reward to the warrior who attacks and captures Kiriath Sefer, his daughter's hand in marriage. Again, don't be squeamish, she's very happy about it. And when Othniel, Caleb's nephew, wins, and we'll meet him again soon, she shows the measure of her faith in God. She asks for a field and some springs. See, she knows that God will keep his promise and that they will stay in the land. And so she claims her portion of it. It's wise. It's a sign of a faithful person. And notice, it's the woman who shows that faithfulness. Don't believe what it says about the Bible downgrading women. This is a faithful woman in action. And it's a reminder that there will always be faithful people somewhere, even when the world seems like it's going mad. So don't lose heart. So lots for us to learn already from this fascinating book. We've seen a God who keeps his promises, and a people who make merely a nod at keeping theirs. And as the book unfolds, we'll see the terrible consequences of those choices. But we've also seen that it is possible to be faithful even when those of you around are not. And not by weeping and feeling bad, but by living faithfully in the light of God's promises. So may God help us to be people who don't settle with partial obedience, but who follow God wholeheartedly. Lord, I pray. Our loving Father God, we thank you that you are a faithful God who keeps your promises. We thank you that you don't just turn a blind eye to wickedness, that you see what's going on, and that at the right time you will bring judgment. We thank you that you do place your faithful people in your world to make a difference, to trust in your promises. And so we pray that you would help us to be faithful people today, in a world which largely doesn't know you, doesn't want to know you. Help us to stay faithful and to make a real difference. For we ask in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Well, let's stand, shall we, and declare our faith.
I believe and trust in God the Father, who created all that is. I believe and trust in his Son, Jesus Christ, who redeemed humankind. I believe and trust in his Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God. I believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
So do you sit as we're led in prayer. Thanks, Martin.
Let's bow our heads in prayer. Oh, Lord God, we have so much to be grateful for. We thank you for your salvation. We thank you for your mercy. But also, Lord, we thank you for answered prayer and also your timely guidance. Thank you, Lord, that you do speak today. Thank you, Lord, that you speak directly into our lives. Lord God, as we think of you as a loving God, a loving leader, kindle us, Lord, kindle within us the fire of servanthood. Kindle within us, Lord, the willingness to serve. Kindle within us, Lord, the willingness to be merciful, even when those around us are not merciful. Lord, we want to thank you, however hard it may be, Lord, that when we're insulted for who we are, for what we stand for, Lord, that we rejoice in that. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we bring to you an incident in London which happened recently, the 7-year-old girl who was shot and critically wounded. So, Lord, we pray for her. We pray for the other victims. We pray for their families. And, Lord, we pray for her healing, Lord. Also, in the light of this, we lift up the relatives of the victims of the plane crash in Nepal, where 40 people are dead. Lord, we pray for your presence to be with their families in this terrible time. Also, we think of areas of the world where there's ongoing conflict. We think of Ukraine, Afghanistan, Syria, Yemen. Lord, we pray for all those who are working for peace to bring about an end to conflict. Lord, we pray for Joe Biden, Vladimir Putin, Eric Stoltz, Jens Stoltenberg, Rishi Sunak, Emmanuel Macron, all the other leaders, Lord, that they make wise, timely, measured, but prayerful decisions. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Dear Lord, we also bring to you the family of this British-Iranian man who was executed. Lord, we pray for the leaders of this country, for Iran. We pray that you will soften their hearts. Lord, if you can change Paul's heart on the Damascus Road from someone who hated you into someone who loved you and served you faithfully, you can do it for them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Also, Lord, we lift up those of us who are struggling with debt, unemployment, bereavement, depression, fear, anxiety, and low self-esteem. Lord, may they feel the warmth of your embrace and know your love. But also, Lord, we pray for ourselves that you change us, mold us, transform us. Society tries to reform prisoners, but Lord Jesus, you transform, not just reform. So Lord, we ask that we do not leave here without being transformed by your grace. We ask, Lord, that you accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thanks, Martin. Would you stand for the peace? Saviour Christ is the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace, there shall be no end. Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's share together a sign of God's peace. So we remain standing as we sing our next hymn this morning. Behold the Lamb who bears our sins away. And of course, that's where our hope lies, isn't it? On the day of judgment, in Jesus who paid the price for our sin.
Thank you.
celebrate together the gifts and grace of God.
We take this bread, we take this wine, to follow Christ's example and obey his commands.
The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
True and living God, the source of life for all creation, you have made us in your own image. Always and everywhere we give you thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord. Because by the leading of a star you have revealed him to the world in human form, that in following him we are brought out of darkness into his marvellous light. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we praise your glorious name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Bendigedi goiti ddiw hollathiog, a miragwe ddiesu, y nos a bredochwyd ef gymryd bar, ac wedi rhoi diolch I ti, fe toro, a'i rwy i ddisgyblu yn y dweud, cymerwch bwytewch, hwn i fy hoff a roddi drosoch, rhag hyn e'r cof amdano. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given you thanks, he gave it to them and said, drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come in glory.
Therefore, loving God, recalling now the sacrifice of Christ your Son, once for all upon the cross, and the triumph of his resurrection, we ask you to accept our sacrifice of praise. Send your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts, that we may be fed with the body and blood of your Son, and be filled with your life and goodness. Unite us in Christ and give us your peace, that we may do your work and be his body in the world. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever.
Amen.
So, as our Saviour taught us, we boldly pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, for we all share in one bread.
Lamb of God,
you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
So come, let us receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ given for us, and feed on him in our hearts by faith, with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
thanks to the Lord, for he is gracious. Generous God,
you have fed us at your heavenly table. Kindle us with the fire of your Spirit, that when the Lord comes again, we may shine as lights before him, who is alive and reigns in glory forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
It is lovely to see everybody back after Christmas and to have Sunday school back. I can see you've got something prepared. Do you want to go first before the notices?
Yes.
Yeah, go on then. You tell us what you've been up to. And
okay, so who have we been learning about today? Who did we have on our fingers?
Jesus.
And Nicodemus. And what did Nicodemus do? Learning about being born again. But we have a song for you. I'm not sure how loudly you'll hear it.
But we've actually, you could try out, we've got a Bluetooth receiver on our sound system that was put in this week. Done, everyone.
It's a good one,
isn't it? Yeah, that's brilliant. Beautifully sung too. What a great message, because of course, thinking about what we were thinking about in church, about the Canaanites and God's people themselves, actually that's what they didn't do. They didn't come to God and say sorry and want to follow him, did they? The Canaanites went their own way and God's own people only wanted to partially follow God, and that was the big problem. And it's the big tendency for us too. So what a great message to be reminded of. So if you didn't read your email from me, I know lives are busy, there is an attachment on it with more information about how to understand the Book of Judges. There are a limited number of hard copies at the back as well. There's extra information on there. Some of it will relate to what Rhiannon will be saying next week about the patterns, the cycles that we'll see in the book. Others are about how to understand what was going on with the conquest of Canaan. So do read that attachment. I did it as a PDF, so you should all be able to read it. But you are welcome if you don't do computers or find it difficult to read on the screen. There's a limited number of hard copies there to help with that. And when home group resumes, so it's a week on Thursday, the last Thursday in the month, at Martin and Corrine's house. Do ask them where they live, if you'd like to come. We will be looking at these first two chapters or so of Judges and really delving into it. And I'll be there to answer questions as well. So don't be afraid of asking questions. Provided you want to know the answer, those are good questions. Don't feel it's a silly question, or that people will think you're stupid. They won't. They're probably thinking the same thing themselves. So we'll get more into the Book of Judges in home group. Everything's back as normal this week with the meet on Mondays, the cafe, the warm space, the communion service, community choir, youth club, all of that. Thank you for those who prayed for youth club starting back. We did have 20 young people here on Friday night, so we're really thrilled by that. So do keep praying for those young people. We are planning to start a youth alpha before youth club on Fridays after half term. So that'll be an opportunity for the young people to go a little bit deeper. Most of them have got no contact with church at all, apart from what happens on a Friday night. So so do pray that some will want to come to that. And for anybody who wants to be admitted to communion, if you're 7 and up, or if you're over 14 and want to be confirmed, that will also double up as a preparation course for that. Reshma, you've got something to say about CAP.
Yes, so we're running some more CAP courses. The next one's on the 23rd and 30th of January. But I am looking for someone to come and speak about Judges 3 and 4
But they're all on the bulletin.
Yeah, but
already.
Don't worry if you can't volunteer for all of them. I think Reshma would just be really grateful for somebody to volunteer for the 23rd and the 30th of January. As she says, just to be alongside her, to support, to make teas, to be welcoming, and to be friendly to those who come. Have a word with Reshma afterwards. It's really, really vital. It's such an important thing, especially at the moment. There's no doubt all of you got your fuel bills like I did for last month, and were no doubt shocked, as I was. So lots of need for it. So do please support Reshma and the work of the church in that. Anything else? Martin? Yeah, we've got church council meeting tomorrow, so please pray for that, and the hub management meeting on Wednesday afternoon. So lots of businessy things, but really important for the smooth running of everything. So do please pray for those things if you're not on them. And if you are on them, please don't forget they're happening. Anything else? No? Well, let's stand and sing our final hymn, He Who Would Valiant Be.
Oh,
Christ, the Son of God, gladden your hearts with the good news of his kingdom. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with each one of you, now and always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name